All right, good morning. Let's try it one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good, excellent, great job. Welcome to Oakwood Bible Church. We're very glad to have you all here. I'd like to invite you to stand for the call to worship. The Word of the Lord says in Hebrews chapter 13, verses 12 through 15, "So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. Through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of the lips that acknowledge his name." Let us join together in singing a sacrifice of praise to God this morning.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Thank you.
So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath.
There. This morning, as we go to the Lord in prayer, would you please pray with me this morning? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you are to us. We thank you that there's no other means by which we stand other than through you and because of you. Lord, we thank you that you are our God. And Lord, that you have purposed to save us by your sheer grace toward us through sending your Son, Jesus Christ, on our behalf. Lord, we thank you for his perfect life and his death on the cross in full payment of all of our sin and debt once and for all, that we might be forgiven and restored and given new life. For this, Lord, we praise you and thank you, because we know we're not worthy of such things. We're not worthy of such grace, such mercy. And yet, Lord, you've been so incredibly kind to us. You've demonstrated so much favor toward even us. And Lord, as we gather today, we are mindful of all that's going on in our world. Difficulties, even across our country. We think of those who are hurting in San Jose, California, the senseless loss of loved ones. And Lord, our heart just grieves as we look at our world, and there's just so much anger and so much rage. It just doesn't seem like there's any grace or kindness. And Lord, our hearts go out to our very own Sherry Felton, whose father passed last evening. Lord, we just pray for comfort for Sherry and especially her mother in these coming days, the whole family. But Lord, we thank you that no matter what is going on in our lives, you are with us. Whether we're facing global issues, unrest in the Middle East, oh God, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord, we pray for conflicts to cease, that people would come together and love each other and love you more than all else. But Lord, closer to home, we think of our own community where there's unrest here too. People who are hurting, people who are angry, full of strife. And even in our own congregation, Lord, we think of those who are facing financial troubles or difficulty in the workplace, health concerns on the horizon, loss, relationships that are going the wrong way. Lord, you know it all well. You know all that we're dealing with. And Lord, we thank you that we can come to you and we can lay our burdens down and you hear us and you come alongside us to comfort us and uphold us, to encourage us. Lord, we thank you for this place that we can gather in your name freely, praising you for those who have sacrificed much as we remember this Memorial Weekend, all those who laid down their lives, that we might have freedom to worship, to follow after you. So Lord, we give this service to you. It is yours, and we long for you to be lifted up, glorified in and through it, as we have just sung your praise, and in a moment as we hear your word and we consider some ministry opportunities. God, we want you to have your way in this place. And Lord, may that start with us. May it start with our hearts. So Lord, move in our midst, we ask. And we thank you so much for your presence with us. For Lord, we know that as we gather, you are here. You're here in our midst. So Lord, thank you. Thank you for your presence. And thank you for this time. We pray all this in your Son's wonderful and awesome name this morning. Amen. Tom.
Well, we want to welcome you today, this beautiful Memorial Day weekend, to our worship service. And if you're visiting with us, we are so glad you're here. We'd like to get to know you a little better. And if you would take one of the community cards and fill it out, we'd appreciate that. and place it in the box as you leave this morning so we can get to know you better. And as you leave, we'd like to have you take one of the gifts, a parting gift that we have for you in the Connect Center. Just feel free to pick one up and take that with you, and we hope to see you again soon. A few other things I'd like to mention at this time. Today, following this service, we'll have our annual pig roast. And there's going to be plenty of food there, so if you haven't signed up for that, we want you to stay and join us, if you will. Gary's been working on that overnight, him and some of his family members, and he always does a great job, so we look forward to that. This other special note, you'll find this in your program. Our COVID team has met and reevaluated our current COVID protocols and recommended that we move from a congregation-wide to a individual approach. So these new guidelines have been included in our program today and also in our Thursday update. So please be familiar with that. There are some pews that are not roped off, you'll notice, and so on. There's different protocols with masks. That's something for you to consider, and we want everyone to feel comfortable, so that's the main thing, and safe. This is the last Sunday of our fiscal year, believe it or not. Wow. So if that might affect your what you plan to give, we encourage you to do that as well today. And we have something new we're starting today. In your program, you found an insert like this, and it features two of our missionaries. This is called our missions moment. And I'm just going to briefly tell about each of these missionaries. And the object is to get them more in the forefront so you get to know them better. Also that you will pray for them at home during this next month, because this is just going to be done the last Sunday of the month. We'll feature two more missionaries next month. So you might want to put this on your refrigerator, you know, maybe turn it around after a few days and remind you of the other missionary that's on there. But please be praying for our missionaries that we're featuring at this time. So let me begin with Annalisa and Ian Kelly. Many of you remember Annalisa before she got married, which wasn't too long ago, Annalisa Forsgren. But she's been working on campus at Western. A church has been established, not a building, but the people that make up a church. And so she and her husband are working with that ministry. It's a ministry of outreach on campus, of evangelism, and training believers, new believers, in the Word of God. There's an international student ministry that's part of this that they're excited about, and it's growing. There's like seven countries represented in that group. So there's a lot of exciting things going on, and we as a church have helped with special projects in the past. Maybe you had a part in that. Some of the prayer requests I just want to highlight is pray for the summer online and in-person Bible studies, for the discipleship program that will go through the summer, and for the team as they make plans for the fall. And then the other missionaries we're featuring today are Scott and Sharon Gilbertson, who have helped us and monthly help us with Children's Church. But we've been supporting them for a number of years as they served under CEF Ministries. They've been working full-time with children for around 20 years. And there's something new that has come about. Recently, they joined RBM Ministries. And on August 1st, Scott will assume the position of executive director of RBM Ministry. And so they have a heart for children, and they're concerned about the schools that have been closed due to COVID. So that's one thing that they want us to pray about, that the schools, public schools, will be open for in-person teaching so that they can carry on the release time Bible studies, or Bible classes, that they've had in the past. So some prayer requests are that was one of them concerning the schools, and that the Lord will raise up new workers to replace those who are retiring in the near future. So let's remember Scott as he takes over as director, and they're also excited about, they're going to help us with our VBS coming in July. So we look forward to that. So one quick thing too, Bernard Ondiak needs our prayers. He has COVID and he's in Kenya, and he has a very vast ministry there, and we love to hear him when he's here. But pray for him. This COVID has affected his kidney. His kidney function is only 12%. And yet they think they can manage this and treat him. So let's continue. Let's pray for Bernard as well. So let's take a moment to pray, shall we? Father, we thank you for the Gilbertsons and for their ministry over the years. And as it continues, we pray especially for Scott as he takes over the reins of RBM Ministries as director, executive director. May you give him wisdom in this and the insights he needs, and bless both he and Sharon as they continue serving you in this ministry. We do pray that the schools would be more open this coming school year for in-person classes, for the release time Bible classes that they would be able to continue doing again. And Lord, we also pray for new workers that would be raised up to take over for those who will be retiring in the future. And then we pray for Anna Lissa and Ian and H2O Ministries and their church on campus at Western. Lord, guide them, and may you richly bless that ministry. We thank you for the church that has been planted there, and may you help the students in their spiritual walk and in their outreach as they reach out to the community there in evangelism, Lord. Bless in all that. And we thank you for the international ministry that they have, and we pray that that will really go well in the coming days and weeks. So bless the ministry through the summer, and as they look for the fall, give them wisdom in that, Lord. And we want to uphold Bernard today as well. Place your healing hand on him, we pray, and bless his wife and meet the needs of that ministry. And we give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Tom. Please take your Bibles and turn to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 11 today. And of course, before we get too far, as you're turning to that book of the Bible and that chapter, it is Memorial Day weekend, and obviously this weekend is for us to remember those who sacrificed it all on our behalf. They laid down their lives so that we might have freedom, but we don't get to do this very often, but I'd like to acknowledge those who have served in the military over the years, and so if you served our country in some capacity by way of the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, or the Coast Guard, would you please stand right where you are? We want to thank the Lord for you, for those of you who served. Okay. Do we just have, there he is, my dad. He's the only one right there. So, thanks, Dad. Oh, I didn't want to miss anybody. So you can imagine, first service, we had a lot more people stand. It was very cool. So, all right, we're in Acts chapter 11. We have 30 verses of sheer awesomeness, and then we get to have a pig roast. So I know I'm standing in the way of that, so I'll try to move through this as quickly as possible. But we don't want to miss anything here. Take a look at verse 1 of Acts chapter 11 in our study as we continue our survey through the book of Acts. Now, the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party criticized him, saying, "You went to uncircumcised men and ate with them." But Peter began and explained it to them in order. "While I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending, being let down from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to me. Looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air. And I heard a voice saying to me, 'Rise, Peter, kill and eat.' But I said, by no means, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth. But the voice answered a second time from heaven, what God has made clean, do not call common. This happened three times, and all was drawn up again into heaven. Behold, at that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were, sent to me from Caesarea. And the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen the angel stand in his house and say, send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will declare to you a message by which you will be saved, you and all your household. As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them, just as on us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? When they heard these things, they fell silent, and they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists, also preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. And the report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. And now in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. This took place in the days of Claudius. So the disciples determined everyone according to his ability to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. May the Lord add his blessing at the hearing and the reading of his word this morning. Years ago, when I was a kid, I could run like the wind. When I was in fifth, sixth grade, you know, they had the mile run, you know, every year for the fitness test or whatever. And I would run the mile, and I would beat everybody in my class. And I didn't win, I wasn't just barely, man, I nailed it. I passed everybody up, and I could just run forever. I never ran out of gas, and I was fast. So we got to junior high, and then they had track in junior high. I was like, this is great. I go out for track, and I found my place in the 880-yard run. That's back when they still had yards. They don't have yards anymore. They have meters, right? But it was the 880-yard run, or two laps around, if you will. It's the half mile, right? And again, I was pretty fast. And early on in the season, we had this opportunity to go run at a track meet at Eureka College in Illinois, Eureka, Illinois. And at Eureka College, it was the first track with the polyurethane track, the rubber track, right? Before that, it was all cinder track. Anybody fall down on cinders before? That's a good time, right? Not a good time. Leaves all kinds of messes on your knees and stuff. But man, this rubber track, I with these little short spikes, man. And I ran so fast that first time on that track. I ran the half mile as a seventh grader at 2:31.3, 2.5 minutes, and it was a school record, so I got my name up on the wall. It was awesome. So by the end of the year, the sectionals roll around for the junior high schools, I'm going to be at the sectional meet, and it's a lot of butterflies. You're getting excited about racing, and I was ranked like the number three runner in the whole group, and guess what? It's going to be at Eureka College, the place where I broke the school record. Yes, it's all coming together for me. And I got to the starting line, and the gun went off, and off I went, and I ran as fast, as hard as I could. And I saw the tape, and as the tape was coming, I came in absolute, complete last. Well, what happened? Well, in the couple months between the beginning of the season and the end of the season, I hit puberty. And, you know, you're just running like, I was totally messed up. All of a sudden, I was super slow and gangly and a whole host of things I've never recovered from. But usually, when growth takes place, it should be a good thing, right? In that case, it really wasn't. In most cases, growth, as we know, is a good thing. And as Christ followers, by way of transition, we should be doing all we can to grow spiritually as individuals and as a church community. By the way, the alternatives to spiritual growth include stagnancy, embracing the status quo, stuntedness, or even death. If we resolve not to grow, it's very easy for us to slip into complacency, apathy, or lethargy. But God has better things in store for us as we walk with Him. As we'll see today, inevitably, it's not uncommon for us to face criticism as we grow in our faith as individuals and as a church. When this happens, we need to take the time to explain what's going on in our lives in reasonable ways. We need to talk about what God is doing and hold on to what Jesus said. We need to do all we can to stay out of God's way as we praise Him for unity. And in time, God will bless our growth as we expand our horizons and winning others to Christ, and as we exhort others to remain faithful to the Lord. And along the way, God will give us the ministry partners we need to help us equip the church and to strategically demonstrate the love of Christ that people so desperately need. As we studied last week, Peter has just witnessed an incredible event in Cornelius' house in Caesarea. The Holy Spirit had just been poured out onto the Gentiles in the same exact way that the Holy Spirit had come upon the Jews in Acts chapter 2. And now as Peter returns to Jerusalem, the apostles and Christian brothers there begin criticizing him for spending time with Gentiles, those uncircumcised men. So now Peter takes the time to explain what has happened and why it matters. And today I have five truths for our consideration to help us grow as a church and in our individual lives as we experience spiritual growing pains. But before we study, let's ask God's help. Would you please pray with me? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this moment in time where we can dive into your word and study what you have to say. Lord, we ask that you'd help us not to miss anything you have for us, not only as individuals, but as a church. Oh God, be our teacher today, moving us by the power of your Spirit. Enlighten our hearts. Open our minds to see what you have in store for us as we work through our growing pains as a ministry and as people. Thank you, Lord, for attending to us today. Thank you for your presence with us. We pray all this in your Son's wonderful and awesome name. Amen. In your sermon notes outline, here's the first truth that we'll consider. The first truth is simply this. Criticism will come as we grow as a church. It's going to happen. I've experienced it. I've seen it. Criticism will come as we grow as a church. First of all here, we need to explain things in reasonable ways. When the criticism comes, we need to take time to explain what's going on, what we're trying to accomplish. Notice what happens in verse 1. Now the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party, the Jews, criticized him. That's what happens sometimes in ministry. People get critical. They start crabbing about things. And they said, you went to uncircumcised men. You went to the Gentiles, the non-Jews, and you ate with them. Gasp. And Peter began and explained it to them in order. Sometimes when the criticism comes, we need to take the time to explain things in reasonable ways, as Peter does here. So who are the players? The apostles and the brothers. These are the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem. And they heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God, these Gentiles, these non-Jews. Again, for the Jews, it was initially an ethnic-centric thought that the good news of Jesus Christ was only for the Jews. But Peter went up to Jerusalem, up from Caesarea, literally up. When you're on the coastland in Caesarea, you actually go up to Jerusalem. So the text is actually very literal here. And he's having now to deal with the circumcision party, the Jews who are criticizing him. You went to uncircumcised men and you ate with them. Now, it's very easy to become annoyed and irritated when people start crabbing about things. In other words, it's very easy to become full of crabbing when you're being crabbed at, right? And you get a double crabbing taking place. But sadly, there will always be crabby people. There just will be. There are crabby people in the world. Look around what's going on in our culture right now. People are upset and hot about stuff that just doesn't matter. People are bent out of shape about all kinds of crazy things that just doesn't matter at all. I don't know if you saw in the news, there's a stewardess who lost a couple teeth this week because of an unruly passenger on a flight. You're like, you're kidding me. We can't just even sit for a while and go on a trip? No. We're crabbing. We're upset. We're frustrated. We're angry people. This has got to stop. I know about crabby people. I was a State Farm agent for 10 years in Wisconsin. And boy, people, they don't like insurance people, I tell you that. The insurance would go up 5 cents. It'd go up a nickel. And people were like, whoa, you bunch of thieves and robbers. It's a nickel. Come on. Work with me. It's easy for us to become annoyed and irritated when people start crabbing about things. And by the way, as a pastor, you would not believe some of the things I've had people crab about. It's so sad. I won't bore you with all the list of things. But you went to uncircumcised men. You went to these non-Jews and you ate with them? How dare you? Remember, last week when we studied, Peter had mentioned that, you know, it's not lawful for me to even be here. But I'm here to share the gospel with you. Of course, this was really not anything new, since these same types of people criticized Jesus, didn't they? Like in Matthew 9:11, when the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" It's the same argument, isn't it? Luke 15:1 and 2, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to Jesus, near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled," that's what people do when they don't like things the way they are, "saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" You recall in Luke 15, the account of the parables that Jesus taught about the lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son. In every case, there was rejoicing in heaven over that which was lost being found, right? But then, of course, there was that other brother, right, who's crabbing at the fact that the prodigal son had come home. Jesus taught in Luke 15:32, through the Father, as the Father says, "For this your brother was dead and is alive, and he was lost and is found." In other words, you should be celebrating this. Instead of crabbing about me eating with these people, shouldn't you be rejoicing that they just came to Christ? Hello? Pay attention, would you? Of course, the Luke 15 account culminates in Zacchaeus, as Jesus makes mention, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." But Jesus was constantly criticized, as Peter is here. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, "Look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners, yet wisdom is justified by her deeds." Beloved, this is what we're trying to accomplish through the gospel. God has chosen to use us to help dead people yet live. I just want to ask you, by the way, how many friends do you have who are non-believers? I mean, real friends. I mean, it's one thing to have a lot of friends who are Christians in our Christian, you know, sphere of influence, but how many of you have actual friends who are not believers? They're really friends of yours. Remember, it says Jesus was a friend of sinners. We lose sight of that. We kind of go, "We're going to get away from the sinners." No, maybe we should be around them so that we could show them who Jesus is. Maybe this would be important. Maybe this should matter. That doesn't mean you go hang out with them and do all the horrible things they're doing in rebellion. No, we need to be different in the world. When outreach starts to take place and people start coming to Christ that don't look like or act like the way we think they should, I pray that we as a church family don't harden our heart against them. But Peter began and explained it to them in order. All right, let's take some time. Let me explain what's going on here. And we need to bring people along with us in our journey, inviting people to join us in what we're accomplishing for the kingdom of God. Criticism will come as we grow as a church, but let's do all we can to be receptive and positive in our approach to ministry. Years ago, Kathy and I planted a church by God's sheer grace. And we intentionally reached out to our neighborhood, and people started coming, and it got really exciting. And when they come, you know, when they come out of the woods, out of the sticks, they don't come sanctified. They come with all their stuff, right? And the church plant, my goodness, it was so awesome. We probably had more smokers at this church than any church in town. And it was awesome. We didn't care because we wanted to share the gospel. In our worship band, we had more new believers in our worship band. I mean, people were gauging, you know, with piercings and tats and everything. It didn't matter. They're coming to Christ. Shouldn't matter who it is. I had one old guy who came to one of our membership classes. Now, mind you, with our church plant, we had a live rock band, and it was loud. And I know it was loud. I played the drums. I can play louder, by the way, if you want me to. And it was super loud. And I had one guy who comes to the membership class, goes, you know, you're going to have to change your music. It's way too loud. And I said, look, man, when we started this church, we didn't start this church for you. We started the church to reach people in this community who don't know Jesus. There are other churches in town. If you want to feel more comfortable, fine. Just go there. It's okay. But we're going to do this because we want to touch the hearts and lives of those in our community. The question here is, are we going to just have church for ourselves, or are we going to be the church in terms of how we reach out to the lost? Beloved, I'd much rather be the church than just have church. This is who we should be by God's grace. And of course, yes, by all means, we need to take the time to explain things in terms of what we're doing. And if you identify with who we are, what we're doing, what we're trying to accomplish, then so be it. Please, we want you to join us in our effort as we reach out to this community. But secondly here, we need to talk about what God is doing. When the criticism comes, let's talk about what God is doing. And that's exactly what Peter did in verse 5. I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance, I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending. He tells this account that we saw last week in great clarity. And this sheet's coming down, being let down from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to me. And looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air. You can imagine, you know, Peter's face squinching up as he says this because they're a bunch of icky creatures I don't even like. And I heard a voice saying to me, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." He's like, "No, by no means, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth. That's bad stuff. I'm not messing with it." But the voice answered a second time from heaven, "What God has made clean, do not call common." This happened three times, and all was drawn up again into heaven. Behold, at that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were, sent to me from Caesarea, as he recounts what took place to these Jews. And the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house, and he told us how he had seen the angel stand in his house and say, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who's called Peter, and he will declare to you a message by which you will be saved and all your household." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. He tells exactly what happens. Beloved, we need to talk about what God is doing. Notice in this account how often Peter keeps pointing out what God is doing. Like verse 9, "What God has made clean, do not call common." Or verse 12, "The Spirit told me to go with them." Or verse 15, "It's the Holy Spirit that fell on them." Beloved, we need to keep talking about what God is doing. And I ask you, what is God doing? What is God doing in our church? What is God doing in your life? Beloved, we need to take responsibility for our spiritual growth, not only as individuals, but as a church. We need to dive into God's Word. We need to keep seeking God out in prayer. When's the last time you were moved to fast over something that was going on in your life? Or to fast over someone who you wanted to share the gospel with? Beloved, of course, it's hard to tell someone about what God is doing in your life if you never act on what God has called you to do. Let's get with it. We need to talk about what God is doing in our lives, in our church. Who do you need to tell? Thirdly here, we need to hold on to what Jesus said. When the criticism comes, we need to hold on to what Jesus said. Look at verse 16. Peter says, "And I remember the word of the Lord and how he said, 'John baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit.'" Here, Peter remembers exactly what Jesus had said. What Jesus had said before he ascended, Peter was there. He had seen Jesus lifted up in heaven. He heard Jesus' words. What were they? In Acts 1, 4 and 5, "And while staying with them, he," that is Jesus, "ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, 'You heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now.'" So here is Peter's argument. Remember how Jesus said the Holy Spirit's going to be given to us? It was given to us, and now it's going to be given to the Gentiles. Peter held on to what Jesus said, and we need to do the same. I don't know about you, but I'm constantly holding on to what Jesus has to say. Why? Where else can we turn but to him? Words like from John 14:6, where Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Or Matthew 6:33, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Are you holding on to that promise from him? Are you seeking him first? Or when Jesus says, "Ask and it'll be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and it'll be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it'll be open." Seek him out. Keep asking. Keep knocking. Fourthly here, when the criticism comes, we need to stay out of God's way. Don't miss this one. We need to stay out of God's way. Notice what it says. Peter says, "If then God," verse 17, "gave the same gift to them as he gave to us." In other words, if they received the Holy Spirit the same way we did when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? I'm not going to be the one who stands in God's way. God gave them the same gift to them as he gave to us. In other words, the Holy Spirit was poured out on the Gentiles the same way he was poured out on the Jews. Who was I that I would stand in God's way? Peter recognized that God was at work, and he didn't want to stand in God's way of what God was doing. And by the way, I hate to say this, but some of us need to get out of God's way. I call them ministry corks. People who keep things from growing or progressing in healthy and awesome ways, they're in the way. Paul teaches in Romans 16:17, "I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that you've been taught. Avoid them," he says. Wow, avoid them. Over the years, I've seen God remove corks, ministry corks, in amazing ways. Sometimes we just need to be patient and wait on God's timing as he pops the cork out of the way, which he can do. But the biggest thing here for us is to make sure that you're not the one gumming up the works. Peter didn't want to stand in God's way with what God was doing. Who was I to stand in his way? Last thing I want to do is be in God's way. If you hang out with me long enough, you will eventually hear me say, "I'm just doing all I can to stay out of God's way. I'm just trying not to mess up all the awesome things that God is doing. I don't want to be a cork." Now, if you're not sure, ask, am I in the way? Am I helping you get ministry done, or am I causing problems for you? What can I do to help? Beloved, we need to stay out of God's way with what he is accomplishing. And by the way, I recognize as the pastor that I have the biggest cork potential here. And I just don't want to be in God's way with what he's doing. I hope that's all of our mindsets. That's our heart on what we're doing, what we're trying to accomplish here. Then lastly, in this section, we need to praise God for unity. Notice what happened here. Did you notice what happened in verse 18? After the explanation in verse 18, when they heard these things, what happens? They fell silent. By the way, it could have gone a different way, right? They could have said, yeah, but we're not reaching out to those Gentiles. They could have been just as hard-hearted toward them. But no, God was doing a work, and they fell silent. No more objections. No more corking. They're going to get out of the way. And they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life. You see how, you understand how huge this is? It's at this moment now the gospel has just been made available to everybody in this room. Hello? Is anybody here? Did anybody hear that? It's at this moment that we now have access to the gospel. Because prior to that, it was just for the Jews. And they fell silent. They said, awesome. This is fantastic. We want to be all about it. This is remarkable. They fell silent. They quit crabbing. And by the way, it's always a good idea to quit crabbing. Did I mention that? Unity is so important in the body of Christ. Check out this psalm, one of the shortest psalms in the Bible, Psalm 133, 1 through 3. Listen to what the psalmist writes. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. Oh, how good that is. It is good when that happens. And now he gives two comparisons as to why it's so good and how it's so good. Look at verse 2. It's like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron running down on the collar of his robes. And you're like, huh? I don't get it. What do you mean? You know, yeah, it's like a guy, an old guy, right? You know, with oil. It's like that. It's awesome. You're like, really? Remember when God gave us the gift of a high priest? That's how good unity is. It's a gift. It's a blessing to us. Just like Aaron was. Or secondly here in verse 3, it's like the dew of Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. It's like the dew of Hermon. That's Mount Hermon in the north in the area of Palestine, in a dry and parched land, having the awesome moisture of dew. It's a fantastic thing. The dew brings refreshment to the land. We are living in a parched society, a parched land that longs for refreshment. Our unity brings refreshment. It is a gift. We need to praise God for unity as He blesses us with it. Paul reminds us in Ephesians 4, I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility. Oh, let's try that out. Let's work on that. Humility. With all humility and gentleness, as opposed to being the person, I've got all the answers, and I'm going to jam it in my way. With patience. Oh, that we'd be humble. Oh, that we'd be gentle with each other. Oh, that we'd be patient. Bearing with one another in love. Oh, that we would bear each other. What does that mean? Put up with each other. Graciously, lovingly. Why? Eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. This is how we should be. We should be these kinds of people. Beloved, are you eager to maintain unity or are you seeking to bring division? Beloved, we need to praise God for unity. Even in the midst of criticism, we need to thank God for the unity He's yet given us. And now we have the rest of the passage. And there's a pig roast on the way. So we got to finish this. Are you ready? So here we go. Secondly, this morning, God will bless the growth of our church as we expand our horizons in winning others to Christ. Now, those who were scattered, Luke writes for us, because of the persecution that arose over Stephen. Remember, Stephen had been put to death. They traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch. So this is this area, the greater extent area of Jerusalem and Judea. They were speaking the word to no one except Jews. They kept going to the synagogues proclaiming the gospel. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch, they spoke to the Hellenists. That's the non-Jews. Also preaching what? The Lord Jesus. Beloved, we need to expand our horizons in winning others to Christ. Here these guys were expanding their horizon, not just talking to the Jews, but to anybody, the Hellenists. What were they preaching? What were they teaching? The Lord Jesus. And at the hand of the Lord, the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. This is what happens when the gospel message is proclaimed. People will come to Christ. Will all of them? No, some of them will. Here they were telling people about Jesus. They were telling people that they normally wouldn't talk to about Jesus, and they were coming to Christ, preaching the Lord Jesus. You know, over the years, I've worked on creating strategies to engage our culture. Back in the day when I was a State Farm agent over in Wisconsin for over 10 years, I was trying to figure out a way, how can I reach my community as a State Farm agent? Yeah, I've got my client base that I'm working with, sure, but how can I reach out to the community? So what did I do? I joined Rotary International, and our town was a county seat, and so, man, we had judges and attorneys, doctors, lawyers, business owners, and we're all coming together once a week for lunch. There'd be some featured speaker, and people found out that I was a believer, even though I'm an insurance guy, and they started asking me to pray for the meal, and I get to share the gospel. Yes. When I went into full-time ministry, now I'm dealing with a bunch of people in my church who are coming to Christ, which was great. But again, how can I touch the community? So I used to be a high school mathematics teacher, so I got hired to teach math at Kalamazoo Valley Community College. So now I'm teaching math. Eventually I was hired to teach in the philosophy department, so now I'm actually holding a Bible at KVCC teaching world religion. It was awesome. God opened doors. When I was in Angola, Indiana, I had an opportunity to teach at Trine University. It's a great engineering school, secular campus. What's your strategy to touch hearts and lives around you? It's easy to get so focused on what we're doing. We need to expand our horizons in winning others to Christ. And, you know, we've got some wonderful people in our own church who are already doing this. Got people like Mark and Marcia Borton who are working with Alternatives Pregnancy Center. There's probably some others who do that as well here. Or Sherry Ruzzo works with the Deacons Conference. Or my own daughter who's working with the Kalamazoo Gospel Mission. Or I think of Dr. Mike Famiano who's working with Nadia's House. And by the way, there's a meeting on June 15th at 7 p.m. with our very own Dr. Mike Famiano. Nadia's House will be hosting Joel Bell from Bethany Christian Services along with one other family for an informal discussion on their experiences acting as host families for adult foster children. We don't think about adult foster children, but Mike has a heart for that and is leading our ministry here at Oakwood to do that. Or Nick and Sky, you crazy people up there, you spending time every week with our students here. And it's a sacrifice that you guys do. But that's your strategy. You're running your own businesses and you're still loving our kids. What's your strategy? What kind of horizon are you looking at as you expand your horizon to win others for Christ? And what was the result? Notice what it said in verse 21, "And a great number who believed turned to the Lord." God will bless the growth of our church as we expand our horizons in winning others to Christ. Thirdly here, God will bless the growth of our church as we exhort others to remain faithful to the Lord. Now, things are taking off in Antioch. There are a bunch of new believers. So what does the church do? We need to send an encourager there to encourage them. Who? Barnabas, the son of encouragement, the perfect guy to send. So the report of this comes to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them. That's what an encourager does. He exhorts them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose, for he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a great many people were added to the Lord. Beloved, we need to exhort others to remain faithful to the Lord. Literally being a son of encouragement like Barnabas, are you encouraging others around you? We think of examples of faithfulness in our midst. Even guys who've lost so much this last year. I think of Gary Cortman, lost his wife last fall, and he's been up all night cooking a pig for us. That's an encouragement. or John Russo, who served so faithfully as our board chairman this last year after suffering great loss. That's an encouragement to all of us. Are you exhorting others to remain faithful by how you live? Beloved, we need to make sure that we don't get lost in our focus on ourselves and our own little world so that we can't even see those who are struggling around us. Notice how it says he exhorted them, Barnabas exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. It's no wonder Barnabas is known as the son of encouragement. I ask you, what are you known for? Barnabas is known as a good man, full of the Holy Spirit, and full of faith. And what happens? A great many people were added to the Lord, it says in verse 24. Two more. Fourthly here, God will bless the growth of our church as we pursue ministry partners to help us equip the church. Notice what it says. So Barnabas, he sees the work that's taking off in Antioch. What does he do? Verse 25, so Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. I need some more help. He goes and gets Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch for a whole year, and they met with a church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, notice it's in Antioch with this exploding church that the disciples were first called Christians, Christianos in the Greek, a Christian, a follower of Christ, a Christ person. It's only there in this moment that that word is used. We see the great chain of ministry as the apostles had influenced Barnabas. Barnabas had influenced Paul. Paul influenced Priscilla and Aquila. Priscilla and Aquila influenced Apollo. And all of these people influenced all of us. I'm so thankful for men in my life, pastors, who have taught God's word faithfully to such an extent that they mentored Kathy and I into full-time ministry. God will bless the growth of our church as we pursue ministry partners to help us equip the church. Right now, we're looking for a new youth pastor. We need help with our youth, and we need someone to partner with us in that role. Lastly, God will bless the growth of our church as we strategically provide assistance to those in need. Now, in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over the world, over all the world. And this took place in the days of Caesar Claudius. So the disciples determined everyone according to his ability to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. Ah, you mean they're asking for finances to help take care of people? Yes. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. You know, for this next year, we're coming out with our new budget here in the next month for the year. And the missions team has asked to put $12,000 back in our budget. $12,000 more. Last year, we shrunk our missions budget back. I don't know if you knew this or not, but last year with COVID and everything, we shrunk our missions budget. Man, that's the thing we shouldn't shrink, right? And we want to push the envelope. As we go into a new fiscal year here, we're adding $12,000 back in to help give a raise to all the missionaries that we currently have, to be able to add more missionaries to what we're already supporting, and also to bring some of our local ministries back online that we stepped aside from, like Alternatives, the Kalamazoo Gospel Mission, Child Evangelism Fellowship, and Nadia's House, to name a few. We need to get back at it. We shouldn't be shrinking back. We should be pushing the envelope with our efforts, doing what we can. Notice what it says, everyone according to his ability. I get it, some of you already maxed out, I get that. But some of you haven't even started. But won't you give according to your ability as the Lord leads you? James reminds us that religion that is pure and undefiled before God, the Father, is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. Beloved, we have to have a heart for people that some might be saved. Paul said we need to be all things to all people that we might save some. I hope that's your heart. That's my heart here. We need to be even more strategic in how we provide assistance to those in need in our own community for the sake of the gospel. You know, we're going to face a lot of problems as we grow. One of the things we're going to face is, it's my hope that we end up filling up this place and we're out of space. What a great problem to have. I can't wait for that to happen. We hit the wall of this church. And we'll see where God leads us next. but it starts with our loving people around us enough to share the gospel. Would you please stand as we close our service today? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you are to us. And Lord, we thank you that we can celebrate in just a few moments as we gather together for a great feast. But Lord, in the midst of our celebration, help us not to lose sight of why we're here. We're not here for the sake of pig roasts. We're not here for the sake of just even the sheer fellowship. But we're here to bring glory and honor to your name through our unity, through our oneness. To such a degree that our unity, our love, our joy would spill out of this community, and that we would touch hearts and lives around us. Lord, help us to expand our horizons in winning others to Christ as we exhort others to remain faithful. Oh God, help us to find ministry partners who will work with us. Lord, help us not to be ministry corks getting in the way of what you're accomplishing in and through us for your purposes. Lord, help us to take the time to explain things, to let people know where we are, what we're doing, what we're trying to accomplish for your sake. Oh God, we don't want to just have church. We want to be the church. And Lord, may that start with us, each one in this room, purposing to do just that. So Lord, thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness. May we this day, even today, quit the crabbing and choose to be an encouragement to each other in amazing ways. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you for your son. Thank you for life. And thank you for the celebration we're going to have. And bless the food and our fellowship that it might be pleasing in your sight. Thank you, Lord. Pray this in your son's wonderful and awesome name today. And all God's people said, amen. Go and dine.